Hello, I'm Mercedes Stephenson, and this is the West Block, politics, perspectives, and players. For months, protesters in Hong Kong have been in the streets, demanding their civil liberties be maintained and respected. But as confrontations between police and protesters have grown increasingly violent, so has global concern about the situation in Hong Kong. I sat down with former chairperson of the Democratic Party of Hong Kong, Emily Lau. She's been at the forefront of the global attention on Hong Kongers' demands. Here's that conversation. Emily Lau, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
You've been at the forefront of these protests, and many times you've been the face and the voice internationally of the movement. What is it that the protesters in Hong Kong are hoping to achieve today?
Well, I think the protests, the demands have morphed in the last few months. Initially, of course, people were angry with the extradition bill, which seeks to send people to mainland China for trial. And people are very frightened because over there, this complete lawlessness, you would not get a free trial. And I speak with some authority because I'm on the board of directors of the China Human Rights Lawyers Concern Group. And these human rights lawyers have told us the horror stories. But they are very brave. They stayed in mainland China to fight, to be locked up, to be tortured. Separated from their families, no access to lawyers. That's the treatment. So people were frightened. So that's the initial thing. And then, of course, we had peaceful marches, and then this generated into clashes with the police, tear gas and all that. And the government refused to withdraw the bill. Then people's demands kept increasing. Investigate the police brutality. Why do you call the thing a riot? Can you give these people arrested amnesty? And then, of course, the demands for really democratic elections, because we don't have democratically elected government in Hong Kong. So that's what the people are asking for. And now, of course, they want to reform the police, because they think the police are really too much, much too much. And they really think it needs to be restructured and to be looked at. So the important thing is, we hope they can set up an independent commission of inquiry, truly independent, to look into the whole saga, how it happened, why it happened, and what are the lessons to be learned. And this is something we've done in Hong Kong many times, independent commission of inquiry. But the government consistently refused and make the people more angry. And they took to the streets, more clashes, more people injured, more people arrested. Now over 4,000 have been arrested. So, seem to be no end in sight.
You're here being honored at the Halifax Forum for your work.
Not mine, be careful, it's for the people of Hong Kong.
So you're being honored for what the people of Hong Kong are doing. You're symbolically accepting that honor here at the Halifax Forum, but it's an opportunity for you to speak to some of the most powerful people in the world. What is your message to them about what's at stake in Hong Kong?
Well, I think some of the diplomats I've spoken to, either here or in Hong Kong, they regard Hong Kong as a barometer of how China would behave, because they see the rising China, more and more arrogant and dismissive of universal values. So I think that when the international community looks at what's happening here, and I'm very gratified because the people I've met at the forum here, they're very sympathetic. I've sat through a number of panel discussions, and so many questions were directed at Hong Kong. So the moderator had to say, well, are there any non-Hong Kong questions? So we are very happy, we're grateful. And they can see that this little Hong Kong, the David versus Goliath image, which of course is very captivating to the whole world. And to see that, to make people think that we should not allow Hong Kong to be snuffed out right before the world's eyes. So people, we want people to speak out, to urge China to exercise maximum restraint. And the people are not asking for independence. which of course China would not allow. The people are just saying, you keep your promise of one country, two systems, meaning we have a separate system from mainland China. We can continue the capitalist lifestyle, the freedoms, the rule of law, the personal safety, because we see that all is breaking down. No, China's not keeping the promise. So we are very worried. That's why we have these daily clashes with the police. And we want our friends here at the Halifax Forum and in the international community to understand, not just for our sake, because there are, what, 100,000 Americans living there, 300,000 Canadians, a lot of British people, Japanese, Germans, French. Hong Kong is a very international city, and many international companies operating there. So it's not just for our interests. I think there is a lot of national interest there too. So we certainly hope the international community, we don't want a war. Nobody's going to go to war with China over Hong Kong. But to tell China, hey, you better behave. You made a promise to Hong Kong and to the world that you're going to treat Hong Kong in a decent way, allow them to enjoy the freedoms. So why are you reneging on it? So I think, and China cares, because China cares about face. If China's criticized internationally, they don't think they like it. But if nobody says anything, they will think, ah, wow, that's good.
Do you think that concern about international perception and saving some face limits how far they're willing to go? What do you think China is using as a calculus when they try to determine what they think they can get away with in Hong Kong?
Well, I think the level of international concern and interest is definitely one thing they consider. Just if you look back a few months ago when finally the Hong Kong government decided to withdraw the extradition bill, and one of the pro-Beijing figures came out and told the media, well, actually, we think there's nothing wrong with the bill. But in the past few days, there were 67 statements issued by foreign governments. 67 statements. They counted to the last one. And they were not bombs, just statements. But to them, it matters. So I certainly hope that the international community would just keep up expressing concern, urging China to exercise restraint, because there's concern that they would use the People's Liberation Army to quell the unrest. So far, it hasn't happened. And I hope that, you know, the international public opinion will continue to tell China, hey, that's not on. We don't want a Tiananmen Square in Hong Kong. So I think it is important. Well, the other thing, of course, the most fundamental thing is Hong Kong still useful to China? And I'm sure it is. We've got rule of law. We're an international financial center. You can't find that in any other city in China, no matter how hard you try. So they still need Hong Kong. And we certainly hope they will not act in a very crazy manner.
What is your advice for Canada? Because the Chinese government has threatened and scolded Canada not to say anything further about Hong Kong. They have two Canadians, which they've detained and accused of spying. The Canadian government says that this is completely arbitrary detention. They will tell you behind the scenes they believe that it's retaliation for Canada's arrest of Meng Wanzhou, the CFO, of Huawei. And there's concern for their safety. And at the same time, Huawei wants access to Canada under the 5G network. What advice would you give to Prime Minister Justin Trudeau?
Well, I hope the Prime Minister would stand up for universal core values, not just values that the Canadians hold close to their hearts, but it is what the international community we support. That's why here in Halifax, people from 80 countries are here. These are the core values that all the participants subscribe to. So I hope the Prime Minister will have the courage and the dignity to stand up and speak out. And when he does so, I hope he has the support of the Canadian people who all want to be upstanding human beings. and also have the support of their allies, the Americans and others in the international community. Because there's one thing that China looks down on, is people who are too timid. Maybe they like it, but deep down inside, they laugh at you. So you have to stand up and say, hey, this is not right. You mustn't act like that. So I hope the Prime Minister, Trudeau, would not be intimidated by the Chinese. I know the Chinese ambassador here, a new ambassador, said something to warn the Canadians not to work with the Americans to pass legislation to punish guilty officials. Why not? This is your sovereignty. This is your parliament. If you want to enact such legislation, it's up to you. But if you are intimidated, not only China will look down on you, even your own people, your allies will look down on you because you have no courage. But of course, it takes a lot to act with courage. And you say, what if they hurt our country? Well, of course, there could be consequences. Like everything in life, whether it's for a prime minister or for an individual, whatever you say or do, there may be consequences. So you have to think it through carefully. And you have the courage to say, yes, I will say this on behalf of my people, and I'm prepared to take the consequences. And so will you. Because, you know, it's a two-way street. I'm not saying that you should take revenge on China, but, you know, they come here too. So whatever access you give them here, you should demand when you go there. There's a thing called reciprocity. It's a very civilized approach. But most countries dare not do it. They know. Because in the West, in democracy, it's very open. Their academics come here, their journalists come here, their business people come here. They get free access to many things. But if you go to China, go to mainland China, you don't get equal access. But you don't mind. You accept it. So people just laugh at you. Why? But if you tell the students who come to here, to the universities here, hey, you better behave in a civilized way. Do not go out and harass Hong Kong students. I know they have been harassed. I'm going to Toronto next Tuesday to give a talk there. And we have informed the Toronto police because some people told me that we could have a nasty scene on campus. Ah, well, this cannot be tolerated. You have to stand up for what you believe in, not to bully others, but to defend what you believe in. And I'm sure the Canadians are behind the government, behind the Prime Minister, if he acts with dignity and courage.
Powerful words. Emily Lau, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
That's all the time we have for today. For the West Block, I'm Mercedes Stephenson.